Welcome, everybody, to my stand-up comedy special on the coronavirus. You know, comedians have to live on the bleeding edge of what is acceptable. So the way this thing is taking off, this might have the shortest shelf life of any special anybody's ever done. I'm recording this on a couple of cameras. It's a COVID. And I've basically lost my income for the next couple of months, as many performers have. We figure this is the time for us to continue to work. We want to write. We are compelled to perform. And people keep saying to us, you know what? You got to keep doing it. You got to put stuff out there. And here we are. If nothing else, we're going to laugh to keep from crying. Here goes. For all of you who want to change the world, take your inspiration from the coronavirus. That tiny spiked ball has traveled the world and touched millions of people. You can too. I don't know how well you know country music. Well, I guess it depends which country. Brad Paisley has a song, Welcome to the Future. And I have this distinct sense that we're in a new era. Right? The other day I was talking to a friend and I go, you know, when we used to be able to travel to other countries, and I trailed off, stunned at the magnitude of what I just uttered. I mean, for a minute, it felt like we were in a dystopian science fiction novel. Now when I walk down the street, keeping 6 feet of distance, it feels like everybody could be dangerous. I feel like to be better prepared, I really should have read more zombie books. One upside is if you didn't wear green for St. Paddy's Day, nobody was gonna dare pinch you. And I figure, you know what? I'm Punjabi, the Punjabis are the Irish of India, so here's a limerick in honor of St. Paddy's Day. There once was a man named Trump who gave all of our stocks a bump, but his response to the plague was vapid and vague. Now our 401ks are in a slump. Several weeks into the crisis, India institutes a 21-day lockdown. Leave it to my people to be late to the biggest event of the millennium and still be ahead of the Americans. This has moved fast, okay? The news only a few weeks ago was global pandemic. Hundreds of millions may be infected. Millions may die. What to do? Wash your hands. Really? That was the play? Wash your hands? And yet they told us not to shake hands. Everybody was giving each other that Ebola elbow. But we all decided as a society a few years ago to start coughing and sneezing into our elbows, right? We would be like, I just phlegmed into my joint. Here you go. My mom, for one, is thrilled that we're now doing the namaste stateside. We don't need to make America great again. We need to make America India. That's really it, okay? Throw in some yoga, sprinkle in some turmeric, and before you know it, there will be no more runs on the stores because we don't need toilet paper. Time to bust out those lotas. Coronavirus has got to be China's worst export since, I don't know, TikTok? The $2 trillion bailout bill was like every dinner conversation ever between parents and children. The kids are like, what's in this? And parents just want you to pass it through your system. The American president banned travel from Europe. I knew when Trump stopped white people from coming here, this was getting serious. A note on overreaction. A few years ago in LA, we had this thing called Carmageddon. All right, they were going to shut down the 405 between the 10 and the 101. Now, to most people on the planet, those are just a series of numbers. To Los Angelinos, that was the nightmare scenario, okay? It's a 10-mile stretch of road, some of the busiest in the world, and they were going to close it from Friday to Sunday. And so they said it was going to be a completely havoc-inducing event. And guess what? Not that much happened, and people go, oh, we overreacted. No, you dumbasses. The reason it wasn't that big of a deal is because we all stayed local. We hung out where we lived, we did all of our errands during the week, so it's because we took those precautions that it was not a disaster, okay? So that's the irony of the situation. By overreacting, we will actually prevent a calamity. So please take the right lesson out of that one. I know how we could save money. We're doing the 2020 census right now. Maybe just wait a few months and there won't be as many people to count. Whew, that was dark. Now that I'm stuck at home, I can do all those things I always wanted to do. What'll it be tonight? The Iliad. The Odyssey. Oh, here's episode 4 of Love is Blind on Netflix. Last summer, my wife and I sold a bunch of stock right before a mini crash. We did it again with coronavirus. We had a feeling, sold a bunch of stock on Friday, and the market crashed on Monday. We also have no kids. I'm just saying I really know when to pull out. I had no doubt Washington would put aside the general welfare of the people and get on with its petty squabbling. We can either run this like bipartisanship or a cruise ship. Corona may end up killing more men than women. They're saying estrogen might act as an inhibitor. So by getting curves, Caitlyn Jenner was ahead of the curve. Hashtag flatten the curve. Somebody asked me, have you ever seen anything like this? Of course not. The last one of these was in 1918, over 100 years ago, when 50 million people died worldwide. I looked it up on Wikipedia. There are 13 people right now over the age of 110. Maybe ask one of them. The bad news is COVID is rampant. The good news, FOMO has been eradicated. Coronavirus appears to come from bats. Avian flu came from birds. Swine flu came from pigs. Maybe we need some inspiration from the Chinese calendar. Go back and rename the years. 1996 is now the year of the bird. 2009 is the year of the pig. And 2020 is no longer the year of the rat. It's the year of the bat. West Virginia was the last United state to announce that it had a case of coronavirus. Probably because they couldn't tell the difference between that and black lung. And there goes my chance ever to play the West Virginia funny bone, but I just had to mime that one. We had a family wedding. The one weekend where it was really precarious, we didn't know, right? March 7th, my birthday, pretty open and clear. A fortnight later, everything was a mess. That weekend in between, I'm the man in the middle, we go out, we're wondering, is this wedding gonna even happen? And I was saying this to my wife, to Hersha, I go, could you even imagine the stress this couple is under right now? Think back to July 2015. We're about to get married this weekend, trying to think of everything that goes into a wedding. The DJ, the playlist, the dance floor. I'm trying to think of everything that's important to me for our wedding. The extension cord the DJ needed to plug his equipment in. The songs, whether Spotify was gonna work. My dancing shoes. Just everything that was important to me. And at this point, my wife walked out of the room. Filming on Grey's Anatomy has been suspended. They're donating their medical equipment to help fight the coronavirus. I wrote that joke and realized it's real. Truth is stranger than fiction. When my wife and I first moved to Burbank, the power went out, and we knew it was going to be out for like 3 hours. So we thought, what can we do for 3 hours? And, you know, we did what any newlyweds would do. But what were we going to do with the other 2 hours and 58 minutes? So what we did is we sat and we actually had a conversation. I asked her about her hopes and her dreams and her fears. Have you ever actually asked your loved one these questions? Hey, maybe now's the time. In devastating news, Donald Trump tested negative for the novel coronavirus. I mean, he announced his results on the eve of the Ides of March. We were this close to having our own personal Julius Caesar moment. But I should have known. There was no way this guy was going to have a novel anywhere near him. I mean, seriously, waiting for Trump to make his announcements is like waiting for the groundhog on Groundhog Day. Ooh, is he going to see his shadow? Is he going to give us enough ventilators because we kissed his ass enough? In 8th grade health class in 1989, our teacher, Mr. Hardin, affectionately known as Mr. Hardon, was reading from a source and thought that maybe, this is so bad, okay, but this is the 80s, possibly you could get AIDS from somebody sneezing on you. The kid next to me, Jason Chang, goes, I'd rather catch it the other way. Parasite wins best picture. 2 weeks later, we get coronavirus. Speaking of Asians, the other day in New York City, my friend Melanie Chandra and I did the show called Back to School. She's really good friends with Daniel Dae Kim, the actor from Lost. So afterwards, we're talking, we do sort of that man hug thing, and then he tests positive for coronavirus. So if I get it, I might have gotten it from a Hollywood actor. I mean, if you're gonna get it, it'd be like saying, you know, that time I got herpes from Margot Robbie. That's not so bad. Herpes is just one letter away from heroes. Trump originally wanted to reopen America on Easter. Trump does realize America is closed on Easter, right? Part of the reason this is so difficult is people tend to think linearly. We don't think logarithmically or exponentially or geometrically, and I think two of those are the same, but I haven't been in math class in a while. Okay, the Richter scale, which is really important to us in California, works like that, all right? So a magnitude 8 is actually 33 times stronger than a magnitude 7. And a magnitude 9 is something like over 1,000 times as strong as a magnitude 7. So it goes up very, very quickly. It's kind of like when I was explaining to my brother that the reason the bathtub tends to get dirtier and dirtier faster and faster is because the bacteria are multiplying. And the more there are, the more they can mate with each other and make more bacteria. And he goes, that is so gross. Don't ever say that to me again. My mom overheard this conversation and she goes, go clean the bathtub. I cannot believe that the UK and the Netherlands were originally aiming for herd immunity. That's what happens when enough of the population becomes resistant to a disease. Yes, but millions of people might die. It is a major risk. It reminds me of dodgeball. I'm hearing that Average Joe's does not have enough players and will be forfeiting the championship match. It's a bold strategy, Cotton. Let's see if it pays off for him. Italy has a new slogan. When in Rome, stay home. Just a quick note, you might be using useless wrong. I heard somebody refer to Donald Trump as useless. That might be giving him too much credit. Useless implies not useful. He's actually harmful. He is worse than useless. So use that. Now's a good time to grow a beard. Since New York is experiencing a shortage of medical professionals, Columbia's medical school is allowing students to graduate early and start working. You do realize this justifies the disease of senioritis all around the world, right? How will April and May ever matter ever again to any major? I mean, these are students who are going out to do surgery in the middle of a pandemic. What is more important than that? I mean, it's a noble thing they're doing, but even if you're an economics major and you're like, I don't understand credit default swaps. Nobody does. Yeah, you know what? My major is acting, and I'm having a hard time telling the difference between upstage and downstage. You'll figure it out at the production. Just one quick question. I know I've been a history major for 4 years. What is the real difference between communism and socialism? Have a good summer. The IRS has delayed its tax filing deadline from April 15th to July 15th. Revised plan. Go out, get drunk for Bastille Day, file an extension on July 15th. Okay, so naturally, I am not happy that this is shaping up to be a major tragedy, but I absolutely think we should politicize this moment. I mean, Donald Trump has blamed everybody but himself for everything, right? The media, the Democrats, the far left, everybody, immigrants, everybody's to blame except for him. And this man has taken credit for things that were well beyond his grasp. He had nothing to do with. So you know what? Here's the lesson. If you're going to claim victories that aren't yours, you have to absorb losses that aren't yours. I'm now kind of wishing that Lori Loughlin and Felicity Huffman would not have gotten busted for bribing that guy to get their kids into college. I mean, wouldn't you just have loved to hear this prorated negotiation that's going on? Hey, we paid for 9 months of school and we only got 7. You know, we paid for a full house. Now it's not as full. Seeing just one episode of Tiger King will have you rooting for the virus. I know there are a lot of jokes going on right now about how there's going to both be a child boom and a divorce boom since we're all at home. Okay, that's funny, and I hope there is a child boom. As far as a divorce boom, let's not take that too far, all right? Just because you can't spend 24 hours a day with your partner doesn't mean you're not made for each other. Look, the only person with whom I spend 24 hours a day is myself, and that is tough enough. How am I busier now than when I had a job? There is now this surge in corona cases, and I've become so acclimated to just hearing the word surge and thinking of Uber, like an Uber surge, which if you think about it is kind of a double positive. Based on my eyebrows alone, I'm guessing there's a lot of unwanted hair out there right now. Seinfeld called itself a show about nothing, and that turned out to be more astute than I think they even realized. The 90s were the decade I was in high school and in college, and I remember thinking at the time, not that much is really happening. It feels like the end of history. I mean, we have the debut of the internet, obviously massive. But other than that, nothing on the scale of the 60s, 70s, and 80s, like Moonshot and the Vietnam War and the collapse of communism. And then fast forward to the zeros. Two dreams, two nightmares, right? The dream of Barack Obama becoming president, wherever you are politically. The first time a majority white nation had elected a person of color to lead it. That's insane. And then you had Web 2.0, the iPhone, all the trappings of modernity. I think I said that right. And then you've got two nightmares, 9/11 and the collapse of the global financial system. That all happened in the zeros. And then in the tens, you have the election of Donald Trump, which is arguably more shocking than all of that. And then 2 months into the 2020s, you've got this global pandemic. I mean, gosh, I miss the 90s. A decade about nothing. Not that there's anything wrong with that. You know what is really inspiring, though? Humans are adaptable, man. We have adapted to this new reality sort of very quickly, right? It's kind of like those scenes in Independence Day where the alien ships are just outside and they just look out the window and it's like, what's it look like out there? Well, there's the sun, birds, clouds, alien ship, the normal. Just to keep my sanity, I've muted all of my WhatsApp groups. It's like we're living in an alternate reality, like the reverse of the Jim Carrey movie, Liar Liar. Barron Trump on his birthday blew out the candles and went, I wish my dad could not tell the truth. It's such a wonderful feeling being called a non-essential business. Every now and then, I think these things happen to us to remind us that we're not just people, we're humans. Like, we don't just live in the world, we live on the planet. You know what I mean? Like, The world is what we've created. It's how humans relate to each other. The planet has been here at least 4,000 years, right? It's something that exists, and humans have been wiped out, almost wiped out, by pestilence and famine and war. And maybe it's a chance for us to remember that the third rock from the sun is actually our home, and we need to take care of it. Like, are we human or are we dancers? Like that Killer song, that always bothered me because aren't dancers human? But what it really meant was, are we actors on a stage? Are we puppets, or do we actually have free will? And with this free will, maybe we should take care of our home. It's hard to know where to get unbiased information. I still feel like the gold standard is 60 minutes, which in the age of DVR is 46 minutes. We were watching it, and it's still kind of jarring to see Anderson Cooper on there. I know he's a journalist, but isn't it sort of weird when it's like, I'm Leslie Stahl, I'm Bill Whitaker, I'm Scott Pelley, I'm Anderson Cooper. It just doesn't fit. It's like when Oprah Winfrey was a correspondent on there for a while. They're just personalities, right? It's just like anyone could do it. I'm Leslie Stahl, I'm Bill Whitaker, I'm Scott Pelley, and I'm Taylor Swift. What? People are finally taking social distancing seriously. They really should have just put a former marketing exec in charge of the campaign. I got this. 6 feet apart or 6 feet under. One definition of the singularity is when technology becomes uncontrollable and takes over the human race. Okay, that's the singularity, a technological singularity. But there are cultural singularities, that it's an indefinite article, a singularity, right? Where something happens and you always remember where you were when you heard about it. So a big one in America is the JFK assassination. People who are alive back then still talk about where they were when they heard the news. They'll never forget it. We've had them in our lifetime. The election of Barack Obama, the election of Donald Trump. I'm never going to forget where I was when I heard about these. And this is what freaks me out so much. New York City is used to singularities. 9/11 obviously was an enormous one, and they handled it pretty well. The issue going on right now is New York has been able to handle acute pain, where something happens all at once. One of my favorite phrases is gradually but suddenly. Like, that's how a tree falls, gradually but suddenly. So New Yorkers know acute pain. I don't know how these other cities in America are going to handle it, or around the world, because the cities die slowly, right? The factories close, the plants shutter, the homes lose their value. It's this sort of like sad decline, like a frog in boiling water. But what's going to happen? Like, it's hard to know that in the moment. Like Steve Jobs says, you can look back and connect the dots, but it's hard to know in that moment that's where it all fell apart. That's how coronavirus was, because it accelerated. It was not really a thing. It was slowly in the distance, and it was like objects in the mirror closer than they appeared. Suddenly it was upon us. And how are these cities going to handle acute pain when they've just been so obtuse? When Trump extended the social distancing guidelines to April 30th, I was thinking, 4 more weeks, 4 more weeks. That is a chant I'm going to do a month before Election Day. I think Green Day should just redo its song, Wake Me Up When April Ends. I'm not going to make it tonight. That's taken on a darker meaning. In The Dark Knight, I never go too long without making a Dark Knight reference, there's a part where Joker and Batman are in the interrogation room, and Joker growls at Batman, tonight you're going to break your one rule. Well, I have a rule. I don't drink alone, okay? I know a lot of friends who, a lot of men who play video games and drink beers all night. I have friends with women who will curl up with a book and a glass of wine. I don't do that stuff. Well, I'm not a woman, but I don't do that stuff at all. Like, I don't come in from mowing the lawn and have a beer. I don't even drink on planes, and I get free drinks on planes, and I don't drink on planes. My exception is if I'm landing in Vegas, but other than that, it's still drinking alone. You're surrounded by 300 people, but you're basically drinking alone, and drinking to me has always been a social activity. 14 days in, I broke my one rule, all right? My wife had gone to sleep, and I poured myself some whiskey, and I was sitting on the couch, and I was thinking, this is really lame. So I got up, I put on my Bose headphones, and I started dancing in my living room for an hour and a half by myself. Broke a sweat. It was incredible. And it took a fortnight. So maybe I am a gamer. I love how we spent hundreds of millions of dollars upgrading to high definition television only now to watch celebrities from their home through their jank-ass webcams. I mean, it's like we time traveled to the last millennium. Coronavirus confession. Whenever you send me a meme on WhatsApp, all I do is copy and paste it to all my other groups just to look like I know what's going on. In college, I asked my friend Joe Cucci, I go, okay, I got a question for you. What if you were in this apartment and you couldn't leave. You have a balcony, you got a bathroom, whatever, but you can't leave the apartment for a year. People can come in and whatever else, but you can't leave and you get $1 million. Would you do it? He barely thought about it. He goes, no way. I go, really? You're going to make $1 million in your life in 1 year at some point. That's a lot of money to make. He goes, I know, but I would go crazy. I'm not going to stay in one place. Okay, so how about now? Where the prize isn't $1 million, you get to keep your life. What if we have to do this for a year? Could you stay in your house? How long could you do it? And what would you rather have? Would you rather have a situation where people could come over, or you can go outside, maybe like a cabin in the woods. You can go outside to nature, but you can't see people. Which one would you rather? And it's almost like, would you rather live in the real world or virtual world, right? There's some forward-thinking movies in the future, that would be forward-thinking, where it's all virtual, right? And there's almost no human interaction. Do you want that, which is kind of what we have now? Or would you want IRL in real life, but you have no digital connection, which I guess we would call the 1980s. But which one would you rather have? Ironically, Joe and I just went to Antarctica in December, which is about as far away as you can go. So, Joe, I guess you won that one. Mom, I did not become a doctor, but I am wearing a mask every day. What advice do I have for people? Look, advice depends on the person. If you're somebody who's freaked out right now, calm down, relax, take a deep breath. This too shall pass. If you are not taking this seriously, what the F is wrong with you? Wake up, get moving, freak out. Thank you, everybody, for tuning into my comedy special. It's been a little weird delivering it to a camera. Usually comedians do it to an audience and the camera picks it up. But I just wanted to say thank you. Stay positive. Well, don't stay positive. Stay negative. But you know what I mean. Good night. Well, as you probably guessed, I'm originally from Ohio. I was born in Cincinnati. Well, I'm Hindu, so I was reborn in Cincinnati. Actually, there's a creationism museum out there that they built. I just think it would have been a lot more convincing if it would have just appeared. I went to school originally to be a doctor, because obviously. For a few years I was pre-med, now I'm post-med. Skip the med part, that's really where all the work is. As soon as I got out of college, I went to go work at the world headquarters of Procter & Gamble. My manager was black. Well, he probably still is, I just haven't seen him in a while. That'd be really weird. Calvin, what happened? I got promoted. Hey, he had a really great sense of humor about racial issues. I remember one afternoon I went up to him. I'm like, hey, Calvin, are you free? He goes, since 1863, dog. My sidekick right there. Thank you. I appreciate that. Fantastic. That's really good. I know the next joke, but that's your biggest fear as a comedian, is what if you just blanked up here? That's okay, don't worry, I got it. But that'd be really embarrassing, right? Don't worry about it. It happens in real life all the time. People are in the middle of telling me a story, and they're like, what was I saying? I never know. They always get mad at me. They're like, weren't you listening? I'm like, weren't you talking? Your story. I'm not sure what to do in this situation. I actually cannot believe that people in this day and age are still racist. That is so gay. Actually did not experience much racism growing up in Ohio. People find that hard to believe. Did not experience much racism. Maybe every now and then some white guy might be like, hey, go back to India. And so I did. I did a tour. It was really good advice. That guy should be my agent. That's a really good idea. It's great performing for different types of crowds, diverse crowds, etc. You know, after a crowd like this, mostly white crowd, people will come up to us, the comedians. They'll ask us different questions. You know, they'll say, in a white crowd, usually, how'd you get started?
In an Indian crowd, they come up and they're like, what do your parents think? Luckily, my brother's gay, so that really worked out. Rolled double sixes on that one, honestly. That was fantastic. That's true. My brother is gay. He came out of the closet. Well, we're Indian, so he came out of the cupboard. I've been performing around the world, actually. It's been kind of a cool part of this job. I was over in Kuwait. I'd never been there before, so I went in a few days early just to learn the culture. And these three comedians that were opening for me, they took me around. I was like, take me around Kuwait. And they took me to a mall. That wasn't the guy's name, a mall. It was a shopping mall. I have to explain that. A lot of the malls over there. It was a beautiful shopping mall, but I don't think they realized they were not going to impress an American with a shopping mall. Because we invented shopping malls, right? So this year, these same three comedians are coming to the United States for the first time, and I'm going to take them to Death Valley. I feel like it's the only way to get back at them, you know? I'm going to fly 20 hours from the Middle East, land in L.A., and I'm going to drive them to the desert. We have heat, we have sand. Welcome to America. Met a lot of Persians over there. They call themselves Persian. You know, I don't know if they've looked at a map after 1935, but you can start calling yourself Iranian at some point. I'm just saying you don't meet some guy from Iraq who's like, hey, I'm Mesopotamian. Doesn't really... You don't meet some Mexican guy. He's like, I'm Aztec, I say. No, you're not Aztec. Of course, immigration has become a really big issue now, right? And I can see both sides of it. I really do. I understand one side where people are saying we shouldn't have amnesty for illegals. I get that on an intellectual level. It'd be like, sir, if I broke into your house, like, I know I should not have done that, but now that I'm here, can I have my own room? On the other hand, where we can be jerks, Americans, about immigration. I mean, you know, we wonder why Mexicans want to come here. We put a state called New Mexico on the border. Of course they want to come here. It's newer. We're just taunting Mexicans to come here. It's in the name. Like, the British divided India into India and Pakistan. If they would have called Pakistan New India, my dad would have stayed on that side. Because my people just like a good deal. Same price, newer, okay, we'll stay.